The following is an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.
Game one in the desert. The feel-good Mets, the last ones to the party, are simply feeling no heat. In a New York minute in the ninth, Fonzie's slam makes it 8-4. The unit is unplugged, and the D-backs are backed into a corner. But in game two, the Mets' October magic took a night off, thanks to the guts of Todd Stottlemyre and the wood of Steve Finley. 7-1 Arizona, and an eagerly awaited cross-country flight. New York, just like I pictured it. And in game three, it was the Mets who turned venomous. A six spot in the sixth salted it away. When the carnage ended, it was 9-2. The D-backs are peering over the edge of the Grand Canyon, while the Mets are one away from singing, "Excuse me while I kiss the sky." You gotta believe those familiar signs are out again. Can the Diamondbacks hold on, or can the Mets close them out? That's what the fans have come to see. Game four of the National League Division Series, the Mets hosting the Diamondbacks, leading 2-1. Hello once again, everybody. I'm Chris Berman. So glad you could be with us here. Afternoon fall baseball in New York. It turned out to be a very pleasant day. Temperatures maybe at 70 degrees, and will it be pleasant for the New York Mets and their fans? A week ago at this time, they were just hoping to get in the postseason. And now, in the span of 20 hours here in the Big Apple, they can go from a 1-1 tie in the series to a 3-1 win and move on to the next round, the National League Championship Series. Working with me, as always, is Ray Knight. And Ray, they have Al Leiter on the mound, who pitched perhaps the best game all year by the Mets. That two-hit performance at Cincinnati, complete game, getting him into the postseason. They've got the Diamondbacks reeling. They've got the crowd on their side. Momentum was a little bobbled down there, Mr. Med. You wouldn't fool me. Tough draw for the Diamondbacks.
It's a tough draw for the Diamondbacks, but I think this is a great matchup for them. This year, they had the best records in all of baseball against left-handed pitching. They also are a dead red fastball-hitting ball club. Al Leiter throws almost everything hard. Al Leiter does not hold runners on well, does not field his position extremely well. So if he's not on, if he walks a lot of people, these guys have very good eyes. They can drive in a lot of runs and hang up some crooked numbers. So I'm not so sure, and then they're staring in the eyes of Randy Johnson if they don't win this game. So I think there's a lot of pressure right here on the Mets today to close this thing out.
Well, who they already beat once, however, but they would like not to try it again. Now, Buck Showalter, as we go down to our Buck Martinez, has been very clear all along. I am not pitching Randy Johnson until game five, especially after 138 pitchers in game one. But for the fan out there, Buck, should they be surprised if they don't go down 2-1 to the big unit?
Well, I don't think so. I think the big thing about what Buck Showalter has said all throughout this series is the fact, why do you use Randy Johnson when he's pitching on 3 days rest? I have to have somebody else pitch well, and today, of course, that's Brian Anderson. And the thing about Brian Anderson, this club has a lot of confidence in Anderson. He's not lost since the 19th of July. He's pitching as well as anybody on their staff right now. He has postseason experience. In 97, he pitched in the postseason championship with the Indians. He's got experience. He understands the significance. And the Diamondbacks as a team are confident that Brian Anderson can force a game five.
Well, one thing, Buck, that the Diamondbacks have going for them is that Mike Piazza will not be catching tonight. This afternoon, it's Todd Pratt again. That thumb still badly inflamed. He took some batting practice. Only in a dire emergency would he pinch it, which means we're not going to see Mike Piazza this afternoon. But it didn't hurt the Mets last night. They won it 9-2. Can Al Leiter close the deal? Brian Anderson goes for Arizona. The Mets dreaming about moving on. The Diamondbacks want to go home tied at 2.
ESPN's coverage of the divisional playoffs is brought to you by AT&T. It's all within your reach. And by Quaker State, for protection beyond 3,000 miles under any driving conditions.
Welcome to Shea Stadium, where four times in their history the Mets have had a chance to close out a series in the postseason, and they have done it all four times. A hero's welcome last night and a hero's welcome this afternoon. And Ray, you know the feeling. These fans can really kind of hep you up and get make even you a 4-3 track roadster, huh?
I don't know about 4-3, but they are a big part of this ball club, a big part of this organization, and a big part of winning ball games when the ball games are in balance, especially for the home team. I don't think it really bothers the oppositional team, but they can really get you going.
Buck Showalter certainly knows the crowds in New York, having managed the Yankees in the postseason of 95 as a wild card team. 35-game turnaround this year for the Arizona Diamondbacks, the most in the history of baseball. And Buck's Pepsi lineup is the lineup that won against the lefty Kenny Rogers in game 2, 7-1. So it feels good about this one. Tony Womack, a mere 1-for-13. He's at shortstop in this lineup, leading off, of course. Jay Bell, 3-for-12, hitting second. Luis Gonzalez had a pair of hits in the opener and hitless the last two games. Matt Williams was hitless in game one, but has come on to go 5-for-12 in games 2 and 3 now. Greg Colburn, who contributed at first base, hitting fifth. Steve Finley, 4-for-9 with 5 ribbies in game 2, hitting sixth. Bernard Innocent until proven guilty, the one-time Met in right field. Kelly Stinnett has caught all 4 games. Brian Anderson to hit ninth against the man who, well, you could say he's pitched the 3 most important games for the New York Mets this year, left-hander Al Leiter.
Boy, he's been the guy that has picked them up when they've been down to stop losing streaks. You see there what he did this year, 3-13-12. The thing that concerns me is those 209 hits and 93 base on balls. That's 300 and some odd runners allowed, and that's when he gets in trouble. What Al Leiter features is a fastball, cutter, slider, slow curveball that he's developed over the years, and a changeup, but pretty much comes right at you. You'll see him establish the fastball on the inside part of the plate, then try to backdoor that breaking ball.
So behind the plate for the second straight game, Ray, it's Todd Pratt, who's a good defensive catcher.
Boy, I've talked to the pitchers on this staff, and they say that he attends all the meetings. He's got a lot of good ideas. He studies hitters real well. They really enjoy throwing to him. Obviously, he's not the offensive threat that Piazza is, but he makes up a big difference back there defensively.
And how about this? His first at-bat as a New York Met was July 4th, 1997. He had a 2-run homer off Al Leiter, then a member of the Florida Marlins, soon to be the world champion Florida Marlins. So turnabout is fair play, and Pratt behind the plate, and we're ready to roll. The Mets infield is outstanding, have yet to make an error in the first 3 games, and Arizona made 3 last night by comparison. Tony Womack, and do they need to get him going, Ray? He leads off. He's played both short, which he's playing this afternoon, in right field. 1-for-13 in the series. They got some big boppers behind them, but they need the speedster aboard. The major league leader in stolen bases. We're underway at Shea Stadium with a late arriving crowd. Not because they're not anxious, because, what a surprise, traffic here in New York.
Well, I think a big key, Chris, is to be patient with Al Leiter. He'll throw 125, 130 pitches a game. And he has a tough time commanding that fastball sometimes. I think the key pitch today's game will be the 1-1 pitch. If he gets behind 2-1, he has to come with that fastball right in there. If he's ahead 1-2.
In there for a strike. We should tell you that Jerry Davis is the home plate umpire. Jerry does a good job back there. The veteran Bruce Fleming is at first. Jerry Meals at second. Mike Winters at third. Charlie Williams and left. Rich Riker is the right field umpire. A lot of complaints, grumbling by the Diamondbacks. Riker's job behind the plate last night, right or wrong, that's how they feel, but they feel good about Davis behind the plate. This is the crew that worked games 1 and 2 in the Houston Atlanta series. Then the umpiring crew switch. Boy, it's been a maelstrom for Bobby Valentine just when things are going good. We'll explain that in a moment as Womack sends Darrell Hamilton back a long way. But Hamilton in there for his defense. Not necessarily would you put the lefty in against the lefty Anderson, but with Leiter pitching, a fly ball pitcher, Bobby Valentine said, no question, I want Hamilton in center field, and there is one out.
Well, Hamilton takes great routes to the ball. You see him very seldom having to adjust the angle that he has once he sees the ball go up. Here, Al Leiter reacts. It's just a little fly ball out there, big man.
Yeah, but to the little guy, he's going, oh, It is humid. 90% humidity today. I mean, it seems like a not an October day, more like a not August, but a you know, early September or a late May type of day. So the ball might carry a little better than you might normally think here in New York at this time. This is Jay Bell with a 1-0 pitch by Leiter, and it's 1-1. Bell is 3-for-12, and now the subway, one of the ways you can get here to Shea Stadium. And those fans wish it got here about 10 minutes before, but they'll be streaming on their way in. Now it's 2-1 to Bell, who has been in these sort of situations earlier in his career with the Pittsburgh Pirates. He says he's been up a game, down a game, facing elimination with the Pirates. So he seemed quite at ease, and the count is 2-2.
Yeah, and Jay Bell chasing the fastball in right there before the game. He said that Al Leiter has always worked him in. Today he was going to try to look for the ball out over the plate. There he chased the ball inside. Another pitch inside. So sometimes you go up there with a game plan and the pitcher just won't allow you to do it by throwing relentlessly on the inside part of the the plate, making pitches in there, and then you get behind 0-2, 1-2, and you have to start hacking at those balls just to try to stay alive and work for a better pitch.
Crowd into it early, as you might expect here in the Apple. Calls that away and keeps it at 2-2. Bell this year with 38 home runs, the seventh second baseman to hit 30 home runs. The record for second baseman 42 by Roger Scoresby and by Davey Johnson. So what a year for him at the plate. A little more power in the first half of the season than the second half, but dangerous. But as you mentioned, he will wait. 112 RBIs out of the second base slot is a bonus I think any manager would take. I think I know. Inside, the count is full. We mentioned the three big games that Leiter pitched. Well, let's look at the pitch here.
We mentioned how Leiter likes to pound him inside. This is the fifth pitch, every one of them inside. Only one of them a soft breaking ball, 2-2. There's a fifth with six pitches all inside. Just the way Jay Bell expected Al Leiter to do, able to lay off those last two and draw a walk.
So he drew a walk. Leiter ended an eight-game losing streak the day after three coaches were fired on June 6th when he beat the Yankees and Clements in New York at Yankee Stadium. And then he ended a seven-game losing streak, winning the middle game of that home series. Seems like about 8 years ago now, that home series about 10 days ago against Atlanta, the Wednesday game on the 29th of September. And then, of course, a gem, the two-hit, seven-strikeout complete game performance in Cincinnati Monday night as the Mets won 5-0 to enter the postseason. Luis Gonzalez, who roped the ball in game one for a home run and a double, has been hitless since, looks at strike one. There goes Bell. And Bell is not that fleet of foot. Kraft shows the gun. I think they tried to catch the Mets napping, but he did not have a great jump rate.
He did not have a good jump. You remember he fouled that ball off of his instep on the second pitch on the hard breaking ball down and in. But you see right here, there he goes. He goes on the first move there, but he just doesn't look like he's running real well. Perfect throw here by Pratt, a little up, but easily nailing Jay Bell.
So Arizona gambling, trying to get some runners in scoring position for their big boppers. It fails. And now the count is 1-2 to Gonzalez, who had what a great year he had this year. 30-game hitting streak, all-star, led the league in hits with 206, but the fans will have none on it.
And I think that's a good move there to try to steal an Al Leiter early. The last 2 years, 52 out of 60 attempts have been successful. That's over 87%.
Sky to right center. Agbayani and Hamilton there. Agbayani called for it, but Hamilton said, hey, tell you what, big fella, let me handle it. So two fly ball outs by Leiter and a gun out by Pratt. Brian Anderson will try and tame the Mets here at Shea. Nothing doing for the Diamondbacks in the top of the first. Chris Berman, Ray Knight, Buck Martinez, so glad you could be with us. Game 4 of this National League Division Series. and Bobby Valentine. Well, said if they didn't make the postseason a week ago, get rid of me. I said that about 2 weeks ago, then all of a sudden they're in it. Then stories come out, Sports Illustrated, and maybe kind of rekindled a little flame or two there in the locker room, although he says there's nothing to it. A couple guys that don't like me probably still don't like me, and the guys that like me still do. The Pepsi lineup, Ricky Henderson, the incomparable one, 5-for-11 in the series, leads off Edgardo Alfonso, the hero, game one, hitting second. John Olerud, 5-for-12 in this series, been great against lefties, not the case in the regular season. At third, the young man from Honolulu, Benny Agbayani, hitting fourth. Robin Ventura Highway hitting fifth. Todd Pratt at sixth. Darrell Hamilton, the seven hole. Ray Ordonez, what a play he made last night on Matt Williams, hitting eighth. Al Leiter hitting ninth against the left-handed one-time first-round draft pick, Brian Anderson.
6'1", 183 pounds, age 27. Has a terrific move you see there, the 4.57 under an average, 144 hits. Doesn't walk anybody, comes right at people, throws his fastball, great changeup, and a slider.
Ricky Henderson uncharacteristically swinging at the first pitch. And one up, one down, Bernard Gilkey makes the play in right field. Ricky made an out here, but now Ricky.
Edgardo Alfonso.
Well, this going in, so you see the difference of the leadoff hitters. And well, we said Womack has to get going. Henderson has been going. I'm surprised to see him swing at the first pitch, Ray.
Well, I think that everybody knows that Brian Anderson comes at you early with a fastball or a slider, and then he tries to get you out with a changeup. So the best pitch you may see against him is the first pitch fastball.
This is Edgardo Alfonso. Homered in the first inning. They support Al Leiter in the game at Cincinnati, giving them a lead. Of course, homered in the first inning at Arizona and grand slammed in the ninth inning in Arizona the next night for five RBIs to give the Mets that exciting 8-4 win.
Well, he's thrown three pitches, three strikes, and that is vintage Brian Anderson. He comes right at you. He's got great confidence. We had a lot of sound bites with him. Very focused.
Four pitches, four strikes. That's something brewing already in game four at Houston. Let's go to the judge, Bill Pito.
All right, Chris, this game can be seen on ESPN. Chipper Jones, who has walked five times in the first three games of this series, at the plate, one on a third, one out. Carl Everett, the catch. Andrew Jones tagging. Andrew Jones scoring. And the Braves have the lead, 1-0 in the bottom of the first inning.
All right, Billy, thank you. What a game that was yesterday, Ray, as John Olerud stepped to the plate. But, you know, of all the Braves pitchers, all of them, and of course, Millwood, what he did in game two, and there's no bigger money pitcher, for my money, than John Smoltz, the guy on the hill today.
Boy, he relishes that role.
He relishes this role. John Olerud, hey, just give me a lefty in the postseason. Just walk him on in. So Olerud now 6-for-13. Coming off his 2-for-4, I'm sorry, Ray, last night with the three ribbies.
Just another fastball. You see it again up, out over the strike zone, right down the middle. Didn't hit it that sharply, a little short on the bat, but always seemingly right in the middle of the baseball. Line drive after line drive.
Think about the spot that this young man, Benny Agbayani, with Piazza sitting last night and now this afternoon, was put in. I mean, wasn't even on the Mets as they headed north. 30th round draft pick. 27 years of age. And oh, by the way, game three of the postseason series, tied 1-1. Why don't you clean up for me tonight, big guy? And he goes 2-for-2. And Bobby Valentine said, Benny always delivers. He was all smiles. He's always in a good mood. What a nice kid. And what a great job for the Mets. Became one of the favorites here, the fans, when he went on a home run binge, as you pointed out in the first two games, Ray. We've seen a lot of fastballs to see if we can get around on it. Once they figure that out, okay, let's try something else.
Yeah, they need to throw in fastballs in off the plate. When you lift your front leg this big, you have to get it back down in order to hit, so it's a timing mechanism, but you time everything basically off the fastball, so he hasn't become a good all-speed hitter yet.
Hits this pretty well to left field, but right at Luis Gonzalez, makes a few steps, and the Mets trade Olerud. We played one here in New York. The big fella, Matt Williams, coming up for Arizona in a scoreless game.
Due to time constraints, we now move ahead in this ESPN program.
scoreless in the top of the fourth inning here at Chase Stadium. There is Al Leiter's wife, Lori Leiter, looking on, and two young daughters in Toms River, New Jersey, just down the road a piece, Palisades Parkway, down on the Jersey Shore. And I think we saw Mark Leiter sitting.
Yes, he was.
Right? Mark Leiter, who hurt his arm very early this year for Seattle. Al's brother Mark. Of course, Toms River, New Jersey, the Little League champion. So there's good baseball at every level. Toms River. Lots of good things in Toms River. Breaking ball just missed it to Tony Womack. And this, you know, maybe this is the game Womack gets started. Flew out to center field to begin. Tony is just 1-for-14. Inside 3-1. The only way the Diamondbacks have gotten aboard have been by walks. Bell walked in the first. Colburn walked in the second. Bell was thrown out stealing. Colburn erased on a double play.
As we mentioned earlier, the 93 walks, the sixth highest in the National League that Al Leiter allowed.
Hey, comes back nicely and freezes Womack there, and Womack struggles at the plate. Continue, never struggling, Billy Pito.
All right, Chris, same old story for Houston. This time in the second, first and third with two out. Stan Javier against John Smoltz, and he grounds out. So through two innings, Houston has left five men on base and still 1-0 Atlanta in the top of the third now.
L-O-B.
Left on base, and I tell you, the Atlanta Braves pitching staff can do it as well as anybody. Over the years, they seem like they stack runners on base, and the Glavins and the Smoltzes and the Maddoxes have always been able to make those crucial pitches when the pressure is uttermost on their shoulders.
Leiter ahead of Jay Bell, 0-2. Well, the Braves are trying to do what no National League team has done since the start of this division series in 95. Lose the first game and win the series. Those that have won the first game are a perfect 8-for-8. And of course, the Mets won the first game in this series.
First pitch to Jay Bell away. We talked about pounding him inside, but give you a little philosophy as to why he did it, and thereafter 0-2 went away. Let's see what he does again here.
Fisted. Coming on is Hamilton. Makes the catch. You want to know why Darrell Hamilton's in center field? Why Steve Phillips made the move to get him? You just saw it. That was no easy play.
Certainly not when you have a guy that hit 38 home runs. When you take that big swing, your tendency is to break back, but not Darrell Hamilton. Breaks forward, keeps his head right down on the baseball. The sun is hitting a little bit, but it's still a very high sky, as you see as the reaction of Al Leiter. Talking about emotion, Bobby Valentine said
that's great.
He wants him to be emotional. He feels like that he's a better pitcher when he's emotional. Some people say that he wears his emotions on his sleeve. Al Leiter says, that's the way I am. That's when I'm charged up and I pitch my best.
Luis Gonzalez, one of four Arizona All-Stars, looks at ball one. Darrell Hamilton, the center fielder for the Texas Rangers when they won their first ever AL West in 96. Center fielder for the San Francisco Giants when they won the NL West in 97. And here he is with the Mets, and Gonzalez hits it on a rope. But Agbayani is there. A 1-2-3 inning for Al Leiter with little help from his friends. First pitch to Edgardo Alfonso here in the bottom of the fourth inning. And he fouls it away from Brian Anderson. A pitcher's duel deluxe. Anderson against Al Leiter. Alfonso, Olerud, and Agbayani. 2-3-4 here for the Mets in the fourth. Chris Berman, Ray Knight, Buck Martinez. So glad you could join us for postseason baseball on a perfect day. Low 70s, a little humid, but boy, early October, this is a pretty good job ordering by the doctor. Alfonso struck out in the first inning. Good day for the kids to be out here getting their first experience of a big time baseball game, and I tell you, something you remember for the rest of your life. Foul by me. I remember my first one. You know?
9 years old, game four, World Series, 1964, Ken Boyer hits Grand Slam. Cards four, Yanks three. I mean, I remember. I remember scooping up dirt from Yankee Stadium on the way out. You were allowed to, by the way. You walked out to center field. All these kids, I hope they have a memory for a lifetime.
Pretty good spot there, especially to set up your changeup. Remember, Brian Anderson's best pitch is his changeup. Hasn't had to go to it much today. The one to Agbayani that Buck mentioned. It's a good spot for it right here.
Sends it a pretty good way. Gonzalez back to the track. Back it goes. Back, back, back. He's done it again. Home run, Mets. Nugget on the scoreboard. All the road to center field. Coming on is Finley. He'll have time. One down.
Take a look at the pitch here, the location of the pitch. Here it is. We think change up right there. Ball going down. That is a perfect pitch. That's just a great piece of hitting there. Change up going down and away. Knee high, almost on the outside part of the plate. Great plate coverage there by Alfonso. But that's amazing that he can get down, go get that ball outside part of the plate. That's a pretty good pitch. I want to ask Buck about that pitch after this.
Well, can we make a little determination, Ray, that he's pretty strong? He's got a pretty quick
pitch. Oh, man.
Bucked, I mean, isn't that what he's trying to do?
Yeah, he made a great pitch, and Alfonso went down there to get it. Anderson gave up 18 home runs during the regular season, 17 of them hit by right-handed hitters. We talked about his delivery to the left-handers, how it's difficult with that crossfire motion. But even when he makes a good pitch to guys like Alfonso, they come after him because they're diving out over the plate.
Two and one to Benny Agbayani. Mets on the board. That grand slam that he hit, I know it was at 2 o'clock in the morning. A lot of people have seen the highlights if they didn't see it real time. We couldn't believe that that ball didn't go foul, except that he had such a quick bat and he hit it so hard.
Well, he stays inside the baseball so well. As you see right there on that ball outside, he didn't pull that ball on the ground. A lot of people on a ball down and away will come over the top of that ball and smother it and hit a ground ball. He has that great extension through the ball, takes the bat, knob of the bat toward the pitcher, which allows the bat to lay off a little bit. Has no turn of his left shoulder, which keeps the bat in a position and an angle to keep the ball fair.
A year ago, Brian Anderson allowed 39 home runs. So obviously he's improved himself by 50%. But look at Agbayani, send it deep to center. Finley has room. Penny drove that a long way, about 390, 395. But he picked the deepest part of the park, two out. While they're measuring him now, we can make that determination, Ray.
Well, every once in a while, a hitter or an organization will be able to pick up something different in the way that a pitcher grips the ball in his glove. The Mets' Bobby Valentine is a master at figuring out signs and also watching deliveries, trying to figure out.
He dropped down but didn't fool Ventura. Into the right field corner. Gilkey struggles with it, but Ventura will stop at second base. Second extra base hit for the Mets here in the fourth against Anderson.
Only the second time I've seen Anderson drop down, that ball is pretty much out over the plate, down. Ventura, good low ball hitter, just rakes it right down the right field line. Gilkey gets over there, but no chance for the slow-footed Ventura, especially with two outs, to even attempt to get to third base.
So now here's Todd Pratt catching because of the thumb injury to Piazza, with a chance to double the Mets lead. In the hole, Womack stops it and has time to make a strong throw to Colburn to get Pratt. Fine play by Womack, but the Mets have struck through. On a good pitch by Brian Anderson, a better swing by Edgardo Alfonso. 1-0 Mets. Top of the fifth inning, Alfonso's homer has given the Mets a 1-0 lead, and nothing allowed by Al Leiter thus far. So if you add the no hits, four innings pitched today, and his two-hit route-going performance against Cincinnati, and the last four innings of his start before that, the Wednesday game here on September 29th against the Braves, last 17 innings pitched, four hits, no runs allowed by Al Leiter, right?
Another strong stat that amazed me last night is his last 60 starts.
Matt Williams to left field, coming on is Ricky Henderson, and he makes the catch. Williams is gone. One out in the fifth. Here's Bill Pito.
All right, Chris, Braves and Astros over on ESPN. Brian Jordan is hitting 500. The other big offseason acquisition, Brett Boone, began play hitting 429 in this series. Base hit there, driving John Smoltz, and Atlanta now leads it 2-0 playing the top of the fourth.
Well, when you squander, thank you, Billy, you squander those opportunities sooner or later. And you get hurt. You know, all those opportunities yesterday, Houston, more opportunities today, and you're going to solve John Smoltz. Greg Colburn, one out in the fifth. On May 11th, 1996, Al Leiter pitching for Florida and a no-hitter against Colorado Rockies. Inside 2-0.
The stat that I was going to throw out there in his last 60 starts, Al Leiter has worked into the sixth inning 52 times. That's 88%, almost 88% in his last 60 starts. That's pretty phenomenal. Checking farther into this season, only one time in his 32 starts did he get knocked out before the fifth. So 31 out of 32 times he got his ball club through the fifth inning. That's a phenomenal stat. Just seems like one day you'd have bad stuff.
Seems like it. The Mets, with all their great pitchers, you don't need to know the names, and you know them. Tom Seaver, Jerk Kuzman, John Matlack, young Nolan Ryan. Hit well to left. Henderson is back on this ball by Colburn. Ricky gave it his best, and I guess the Mets still will not have a no-hitter in their team history.
Is that what you're getting to?
I was getting to.
You almost got there.
I was going to stop talking about it after the fifth inning. That was the end.
You started talking about it too early, man. Little fastball out over the plate. Didn't get it in a little bit. Did not get it in enough. Colburn, although he caught it right about the label with those strong hands. Ricky going up, just missed the ball, didn't quite get back there quick enough. I think he would have been able to elevate enough, but he just didn't quite get back there quick enough, and when he was at the apex of his jump, the ball had already disappeared.
I love him still looking in the mitt, just in case he didn't feel it. I'm looking up Webby. Yeah, nah, it's not enough.
Well, that was for us.
I was getting to. I needed one more. And then after the fifth, I don't talk about that anymore. I figure in the fifth, it's fair game to talk about no hitters. Till then, after the fifth, that's it.
I don't talk about them. That's only because I've been in that dugout so many times. If you do, somebody will hit you over the head with a bat.
Count is 1-2 to Steve Finley. Fenley grounded to short to end the second inning.
One thing that Leiter does when he starts to force, he starts throwing nothing but fastballs, fastballs, fastballs. Todd Pratt said that his job is to make sure he goes to a slow curveball.
Hit well by Fenley. Considering he was off the end of the bat and just kind of a pull cue in there. So two hits now after nothing doing, one out in the fifth against Leiter. So a home run to Colburn, single by Fenley, and gives us a chance to tell you that this copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of the Commissioner of Baseball. May not be reproduced, retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without express written consent. So you know what? The no-hitter's gone, and the copyright's gone in the same half inning. Gives us a chance to watch how Olerud holds on, or kind of holds on, the base runner. And Buck, we can bring you in on this. We talked about it the other night. It can be disconcerting for the runner, right? It's hard to pick up the pitch, the ball. Look at what Olerud does. It's almost like a pick. Gilkey to left field. Henderson is there. Fenley back to first base.
The catcher, Kelly's tonight.
This could be disconcerting for a lot of people involved. It's unusual, isn't it, Buck?
Well, it's very unusual, and Bobby Valentine has decided that the left-hander's without a particularly good move like Al Leiter and Dennis Cook, he will play Olerud off the bag and basically block the view of the base runner. Remember, Olerud's 6'6", and it's tough to look around him, so you never really get comfortable as a base runner. See him peeking around. Olerud doesn't know which way to go. Should I go back to the bag? Should I get my break? And it's very difficult to get a good jump with Olerud out there in no man's land. It's a very unorthodox move. Watch Fenley as he works around Olerud. Oh, what side? What side do I go on? And he never really gets comfortable with his break toward second.
And Ray, you're in a pretty good fielding position too at first base, aren't you?
Yeah, you're in a great fielding position, but I'm telling you what you can do right now. We were able to break this in Cincinnati. Jimmy Leland was the first I ever saw to do this. When you get a lead like, you get off the bat like Olerud is, all you have to do is get on the other side of him, go on the first move. See right there, just get a bigger lead. Take another two steps, get on the other side of him. He'll be going back to the bag. You can steal the bag on the first move.
Struck him out. Stinnett strikes out. Fenley stranded at first, but the Diamondbacks have struck back with a long ball of their own. 1-1, mid-5. Tie game anew. Bottom of the fifth. 7-8-9 hitters for the Mets. Darrell Hamilton, Ray Ordonez, Al Leiter against Brian Anderson. Home run Alfonso, bottom four. Home run Colburn, top five. Hamilton flew out to right field and the second inning. Now grounds to Womack at short. He kind of plays that interestingly into his throwing hand, but it goes 6-3 anyway. And Ray, I promise I will not talk, because I'm going to hear about it from Al, who's a good friend of ours. I'll not talk about a no hitter again when he's, until it's gone. You know, I'm sorry. I was trying to sneak it in.
It's not like you always have him going into the fourth either.
I know. So we apologize.
I don't think he heard you.
No. No, they get cable down there, though.
They do.
Ray Ordonez flew out to center field and first out in the third inning. Ordonez now 3-for-11 in the series. So Anderson's settling down. The home run was a good pitch, but well hit by Alfonso. Agbayani had a strong ball to center field. And Ventura doubled sharply down the line the last half inning. So let's see how the youngster Anderson, young, but he's 27 years of age, so he settles in, working at the bottom part of the lineup. Interesting. And here's, going to the fifth now in Houston behind John Smoltz, the Braves, trying to close out the Strohs. foul back. It's interesting to note that in Al Leiter's two starts in the 97 World Series for the Florida Marlins, which would be, of course, game seven and game three, that wild game won by Florida 14-7. Brian Anderson worked for Cleveland in both of those games in relief, although Leiter was gone both times before Anderson came in. They have opposed each other in the postseason, if you will, before. Ordonez gone, and that'll bring up Leiter.
Right here, buries a fastball inside, and that's what you have to do as a changeup pitcher. You throw your hardest pitch on the inside part of the plate. You throw the changeup, your softest pitch, away. They start respecting that changeup, trying not to strike out. Two strikes, you bust them inside, and they have nothing they can do about it. Just look at it.
0-2 to Leiter.
Anderson at 62 pitches right now has gone to three balls only once in this ball game.
One 2 pitch on the way. Leiter gets wood on it. And some applause from the Mets crowd, which is quieted down after that Cole Brun home run. That came ready for Bear, although not lethal here. I would say it's a nice, it's a well-behaved crowd, just enthusiastic. So a pair of strikeouts in this inning for Brian Anderson, who has bounced back nicely. 1-1 through five. Why would you leave? Back at Shea Stadium, a 1-1 game, and our Aflac trivia question. The Mets are 14-7 at home in the postseason, which is the best mark in the majors. What pitcher got the win in their postseason victory at home? And we'll give you the answer the next half inning. And now the switch hitting pitcher, a pretty good left-handed throwing pitcher, Brian Anderson is up. Speaking of trivia questions, one of my favorite is seeing the switch hitting Anderson at the plate. The last American League MVP was a switch hitter. Agbayani, whoa.
Oh, man.
He's riding a wave.
Disastrous.
Riding a wave in there at the North Shore. He makes the catch. But just to finish, well, we'll show you the catch. It was.
I don't know what happened right here. There's not a lot of wind there. He just comes in there. There's no sun. The sun is overcast here. Al Leiter said, mercy me, baby. Nice catch.
Yep. Tony Womack, 1-for-15 in the series. The answer is the last American League switch hitter to win the MVP. It's a trick question. A lot of people know the answer. Vita Blue, 1971.
I didn't know.
Not Eddie Murray, Mickey Mantle. Saw that. Seeing Anderson always brings that question to mind. Very quickly, Womack behind 0-2.
And very quickly, the Mets have a great defensive infield, but they struggled all year long with your outfield play until they acquired Hamilton. Agbayani struggling right. Henderson struggled some in the left. Had McRae in center for a while.
Al Al's pumped up again. He has settled down nicely, as Anderson did. We talked to him about, hey, Al, you know, you show your emotions a little bit on the mound. He said, that's fine by me.
That kind of antic, or what looks like I'm out of control, is really internally I'm very much in control. As a matter of fact, if I look at a lot of my games, my better games are when I'm acting like that. I know even Bobby Valentine said, you know, when I watch you and you look all serious and quiet, and he gets worried. He likes when I get a little flaky.
You got the big flakes this afternoon, frosted flakes. Jay Bell has walked and threw out to center field on a great shoestring catch by Darrell Hamilton in the fourth inning. Just the home run by Colburn, which Finley followed with a single. That's the only, the two walks came in the first two innings. He's been masterful. Inside to Bell. Actually, it nipped him. Way inside.
The left fielder, Luis Gonzalez.
Want to get away from him a little bit? I mean,
he's just cutting that ball. It starts out over the plate, and sometimes you get on top of it a little bit, and it just keeps on riding in there. Got away from it just a tad. But he obviously, his game plan is to pitch Jay Bell in all day long. Mm-hmm. He's only thrown him one pitch outside, 0-2 pitch, about 6-8 inches off the plate.
Luis Gonzalez, two fly ball outs, one to center, one to right. Had two hits in the opener, but since then, his average in this series has gone to 2-for-9. There's that lead again in Olerud's play, Ray.
Well, what happens here, and the way that you can defeat this, watch how Olerud gets off there, and he's blocked you because you get a lead right behind him. You go ahead and take a full step over there, and the only way that the pitcher can get you is pick you off and step off the bag. If you go on his first move and he comes to first base, Olerud's moving back to the bag, you're moving to second base, and you're gone. The ladder does not have a very good move, so what you do is you stretch your lead, force him to throw over there, and go on the first move. Now, I had some pretty good speed in Cincinnati, but.
Ventura to Alfonso. Bell is forced, and that's it for the Diamondbacks in the top of the sixth inning. Heading to the bottom of the sixth in New York, the top of the order for the Mets. 1-1 game, bottom of the sixth inning. Our Aflac trivia question answer. Question. Mets 14-7 at home in the playoffs. Who won the Mets first home playoff game? It was game three, the clincher in the 1969 NLCS. Nolan Ryan pitched 7 innings in relief of Gary Gentry. 3 hits, 7 Ks, and the Mets were on their way to the World Series, which of course they won in 5 games here against the Baltimore Orioles, with Jerry Koosman winning 2 games in that series, winning game 5. But Nolan Ryan is the first Shea Stadium Met winning pitcher in postseason. He won a few other games, too. Hall of Famer as of this summer, Nolan Ryan. Top of the order, Ricky Henderson, 0-for-2, then Alfonso, then Olerud. In there for a strike to Ricky. Ricky fly ball to right and ground ball to third. 0-for-2. Chipper Jones is up with 2 men on. Well, then it wouldn't be the bottom of the fifth now, would it? So I don't know. We'll get it straight. You see now, very dangerous when you have 2/3 of the information. Apparently they've retired Chipper Jones. That's why they're in the bottom of the fifth. It's 2-0. Ricky, with 6 stolen bases in this series, has been a virtual menace as he's been throughout his entire career. Staying alive. Of course, Ricky is also a menace in the base on balls department. Has walked 3 times. And this has been well documented. He is 3rd all-time Major League history in the walk department, behind only Babe Ruth and Ted Williams. Ricky with 1,972 walks. The Babe, 2056, and Ted, 2019. So he's going to catch that, you would think. Runs, he is 5th all-time, behind only Ty Cobb, Hank Aaron, Babe Ruth, and Pete Rose. With Cobb at 2245, so he's could catch that. Not to mention, he's going to get, probably, 3,000 base hits. He is,
well, if he plays
810, right?
If he plays 5 more years like he says he's going to, that's a lot.
And how about he's going to get 300 homers, Ray? I mean, it's hard to kind of.
I just showed you.
Better numbers than that. Staying alive. Not a lot of room here at Shea in foul ground. Stadium built 1964. You know, with Candlestick closing, by the way, for the Giants, stay open for the 49ers. Oldest parks National League, Wrigley Field, of course. Dodger Stadium, 1962. Candlestick was built in 60, but that'll be gone next year. Shea Stadium, the third oldest National League, 1964. Built when the World's Fair was here in New York. Home for the Mets and the Jets. 10th pitch now, Anderson to Henderson. This is what he does, huh?
This is a tremendous matchup here. You talk about Ricky Henderson's ability to walk. Brian Anderson, fourth in the league as far as control, only 1.8 walks per nine innings. So that's why you get to 10 pitch at bats, because Henderson doesn't strike out too much, doesn't swing at bad balls too often.
Bat splintered, ball foul. Yeah, a couple of nights here in the Northeast this week. Put up a little kindling in the fireplace, and Ricky just contributed to it.
Tremendous ratio here. Brian Anderson early in this ball game, actually to the sixth inning, 75 pitches thrown, 53 of those have been for strikes, just 22 balls.
Rip just past Cookie Rojas. All of a sudden, after lulling us with these foul balls, that one had a little hair on it. The hero is on deck, Edgardo Alfonso, and he's seen just about, not that he needs to, he's seen just about every pitch that Anderson has here.
Well, he has. This really helps the offense right here. Everybody, not only they see a lot of pitches, but it ends up tiring a guy out, because what he's doing, he's having to make pitches under pressure. And this is his 13th pitch, all under pressure. He doesn't want to walk Ricky Henderson, and that takes away from your stamina more than anything. And it just, it may not happen with Ricky Henderson, but down the line, when he has to make a pitch, he may just hang something.
On the 14th pitch, Henderson with a base hit that bounces away from Gilkey. Patience is a virtue, and that's why the Mets have a base runner. Henderson has stolen six bases. He's scored four runs, but Edgardo Alfonso, you talk about a week. Monday, home run, first inning. Mets beat Reds. Tuesday, home run, first inning. 4-4 ninth at Arizona. Grand slam, way deep past the foul pole. Blast it back. Home run, fourth inning. I would take that week. Ricky is aboard, and Alfonso is up. Menace and menace.
The 14 pitches of Ricky Henderson in that at bat was more pitches than Brian Anderson threw in the first, third, or fifth inning total.
This should get out of play, and it does. In any postseason series, any World Series, LCS, the record is 8 stolen bases. Ricky for the A's, 5 games against Toronto in the ALCS. Lou Brock twice in the World Series for the Cardinals against the Red Sox and Tigers in 67 and 68. Ron Gant, you saw, a young Ron Gant for the Braves, turned the trick in Willie Wilson, the mercurial one, when he played for Oakland later in his career against Toronto. But the record is 8 in any series. So Ricky has 6 in this one.
Well, Brian Anderson told me that he did not know if he could stop Ricky Henderson from running, but he said he feels he's got a good enough move, but he thinks the key is
that he's going to stop Ricky Henderson's feet. He's going to not let him get a walking lead.
Well, that pitch count that Anderson had nursed so beautifully is going out the window this evening.
That was just one of those classic battles with a great hitter and a young pitcher out there that has depth control, showing you what, how many quality pitches he made. That's what happens to foul balls. Foul balls are just when hitters have a pitch that's too good to put into play, and they just fight him off, trying to work to a better pitch to hit.
Sky to the infield. Stinnett. Now Matt Williams takes charge. He grabs it. One out. John Olerud, one for two, a sharp single up the middle in the first inning. Steps to the plate. Olerud is 6-for-14 in this series. We documented how all of a sudden, at least in this series, lefties getting better off them than righties in the regular season. I mean, that's not even close. One-time batting champ, 1993 Toronto Blue Jays, when he hit 363. A year ago, hit 354, the highest average in Mets history, breaking the old mark, held by Cleon Jones with 340 in the Miracle Mets year of 1969, the year in which Ryan won the game in relief. Seaver, Kuzman. One-and-one, the count to Olerud with Henderson, the runner at first base, in a 1-1 game. Chris Berman, Ray Knight, Buck Martinez with you on ESPN2 and Points Beyond. Glad you could be with us. Been great. That sidewinder, Ray.
Yeah, he's thrown that four times today and has thrown four balls with it. Only thrown a total of 24 balls all day long. Just a different look. It doesn't necessarily mean he's trying to make a pitch with it, but always can put something in the back of the mind of a hitter.
I wouldn't say that Ricky is timid out there, but Anderson's doing a great job, right?
He better be a little timid. I know one thing. He's not going to be able to get a walking lead, and that's where Ricky's so successful. Ryan Anderson said the one thing that he was going to do was make sure that he held the ball, buried his pitch to the plate.
Olerud to the gap in left center field. Cut off nicely by Finley, but Henderson into third. Olerud with a single, in the Mets have runners on the corners with one out. Ricky Henderson run, and that we got to give Anderson a lot of credit there, although there he is at third base.
Well, Chris, the whole thing with Henderson, he's not real comfortable against Brian Anderson. Watch Ricky at first base during the Olerud at bat. He couldn't get a good read on Anderson, and because of that, he couldn't steal. You see how he's going back to the bag when Anderson goes to the plate. He has run wild on the Diamondbacks in this series, but Anderson neutralized him in that particular at bat.
And of course, you can't say that it woulda, coulda, shoulda. Had he stolen a base, then he might have scored on the hit by Olerud, but we'll never know. Anderson might have pitched differently. One of those things. But right now, Agbayani is just trying to loft the fly ball to break this 1-1 tie.
And Buck, I'm also going to give him credit for the John Olerud hit Ricky Henderson because of the way that he worked Anderson during that inning.
Well, this will be out of play.
Certainly is a factor, Ray. And Anderson made quality pitch after quality pitch to Ricky Henderson. And finally, Henderson, as he's done throughout his career, gets a pitch that he can drive the other way and starts this inning. And these two guys, Anderson and Leiter, have really done a good job. And Buck Showalter has said throughout this series, you know what, Brian Anderson is a very capable pitcher, and I'm not concerned about starting Randy Johnson on short rest.
Anderson now trying to distract Anderson a little bit down the third baseline, and that pitch is inside for ball 2-1.
Now this is where you see a pitcher start to change a little bit, not in his mechanics, but his thought process. Brian Anderson going right at hitter, pitch after pitch after pitch. Now he's behind Agbayani 2-1 because he wants to throw the perfect pitch to get a ground ball double play.
Inside 3-1 with Ventura on deck. Strike one.
Although you have first base open with one out and Pratt on deck, you still have to go get Robin Ventura here. You go right at him, try to get an out there, make your mind up then if you want to walk Pratt to pitch to Hamilton.
Good play by Stinnett to block it. Keep Olerud at third. Here's Pratt on deck. To the mound, Anderson checks the runners. What a big pitch and a big out by Brian Anderson. Two down for Pratt.
See the pitch coming right at us there, a breaking ball slider. Hasn't thrown a lot of them lately, but does throw them to left-handed hitters, and Ventura off the end of the bat. Nice pitch in a crucial situation for Anderson.
Todd Pratt 0-2. This will be out of play.
Now you ask the question, right-handed hitter Todd Pratt, left-handed hitter Darrell Hamilton on deck. Left-hander's 295, 31 for 105 against Anderson this year with one home run. Mr. Darrell Hamilton's the man that hit the home run when he was with Colorado. 521 at Coors.
One and one to count to Todd Pratt. Member of the Phillies in 93, had one at bat in that NLCS win over Atlanta, did not play in the World Series against the Blue Jays. A little chop at the third, Matt Williams crossed the diamond to Colburn, but Benny and the Mets have taken a 2-1 lead through six.
Due to time constraints, we now move ahead in this ESPN program.
ESPN's coverage of the divisional playoffs is brought to you by Red Wing Shoes. For the dealer nearest you, call 1-800-359-BOOT. And by Hyundai. Every Hyundai is backed by America's best warranty with 10 years powertrain coverage.
About 56,000. Get the official in a moment. Hoping to see what the Mets have not done since 1986. Win a postseason series. With Henderson retired, Melvin Mora is now the left fielder. So Mora and Cedeno flank Hamilton, who has gone the route in center. 7-8-9 for the Arizona Diamondbacks. Team that won 100 games this year, played with, well, they're certainly, I mean, on paper, they're an expansion team, but with their second year, but played with the maturity and confidence to win 100 for Buck Showalter. They need to dig down and borrow some of that right now. Gilkey's to net and a pinch hitter here against Al Leiter.
John Franco just getting up, warming up in the bullpen. Turner Ward, the big right-handed bat on the bench.
Hit by Gilkey to left. Mora just in the game, makes the catch. Our new era in-game box score, Greg Colburn is the one that solved Leiter for a solo home run in the fifth inning. Finley followed with a single, and that's been it. Tony Womack's struggles continue, and can't say that he's alone, but when you look at the top four guys in the order, and it's a complete 0 for 10.
And I wonder, is that just incoherent? Turner Ward on deck. I just wonder, is that a coincidence that that's the only inning, the only inning that they got a hit is the inning that you mentioned, the no-hitter?
I'm sure I'll hear about it from Al. And you know we will. Al Leiter worked with us in the postseason last year, and I said, we enjoyed seeing you, but maybe you won't have to work with us, but you'll be working this October, if you know what I mean. He goes, I kind of like that. Kelly Stinnett looks at strike one. Leiter continues to have command. He's throwing pretty much the same. Hooray and Buck, I'm going to bring you both in on this.
Well, for me, he certainly has been able to establish that fastball in, has not thrown a lot of sliders, pretty much just worked off his fastball in off the plate.
Chopper to Ventura. Olerud, two out. And now Turner Ward, who had a pinch hit two-run home run last night, will step to the plate.
Number 10, Turner Ward.
And now with Ward coming up, Dave Wallace, the pitching coach, will go out and visit with Leiter and Pratt.
And I'm sure this is just a visit by the pitching coach to give Al Leiter an opportunity to take a deep breath. Bobby Valentine has got the bullpen up. John Franco was throwing behind Leiter down in right field. But Al Leiter all day long has had good stuff. As you look at Franco, he should be ready by now. He's had plenty of time to get loose. But this is Leiter's situation. He's going to face a former teammate in Turner Ward, the switch hitter. Leiter and Ward were together in Toronto. And, of course, Turner Ward hit the two-run home run pinch hitting last night against Rick Reed. But Al Leiter has established his fastball. He's been in the strike zone. And you remember about 97, he pitched Game 7 in the World Series. Last Monday, he pitched that big one-game playoff against Cincinnati. He likes these situations.
Obviously, Buck, look at the way he has delivered. He delivers high and tight toward ball one. Four times in their history, the New York Mets have had an opportunity to close out a postseason series here. All four times they have delivered.
Now that you have two outs in the eighth, John Franco has set down. Armando Benitez, their closer, is now up. So what that tells me that Bobby will use Armando, although Franco is still up out there. But he won't be afraid to use him to get four outs to close this game out.
Inside, ball three.
Well, that's a hitter going up there with a real idea. All three of those pitches just borderline off the plate inside. You've seen most of these Diamondbacks chase that ball all day long. Turner Ward has not bid on it.
Well, he took it, and now he will take off his shin protector. And Turner Ward has come in and now represents the tying run with two outs. And if ever there was a time for Tony Womack to shake the termites out of that wood, this probably would be a good opportunity, at least from Arizona's perspective.
Tony Womack having a very tough series, 0-63 with six punchouts in his 16 plate appearances. Really no right-handed bats over there that manager Buck Showalter feels really good about. You've got Frias, Hanley Frias, a shortstop, and Damian Miller, who has a problem with his hand, so Buck is a little boxed here. Even if he does want to hit for Womack, he doesn't really have any right-handed thunder over there.
Off the glove of Alfonso, Womack with the speed beats it to first.
So the normally airtight infield of the Mets, admittedly a very tough play.
I don't
could
know,
not recover.
I don't know how tough that play was, Chris. This is a very long hop. That ball should not be a tough play. That ball hits way out in front of Alfonso. I don't know that if his glove got in front of his... Angelo's wife really likes it as she jumps up there. There's the owner of the Arizona Diamondbacks, Dave Wallace, to the mound.
Meanwhile, Wallace to the mound, and Leiter leads to a hero's reception, and well-deserved. Benitez coming in a 2-1 game.